Hello, everyone. Welcome to the 2021 Campus Compact Midwest and Western Region Continuums of Service Conference. The title of today's event is The Promise of Full Participation, Resilience and Responsibility for Racial and Environmental Justice. We have an incredible lineup for you all today, and we're really excited about today's programming. So I'll start by introducing myself. My name is Carmen Bruton Dennison, and I am the Executive Director of Campus Compact of Oregon.
Aloha, everyone. My name is Atina Trakowski-Pasqua, and I am the Executive Director of the Hawaii Pacific Islands Campus Compact. Thank you for joining us today. And thank you to our sponsors, State Farm Insurance Charitable Foundation, Portland State University College of Education, and GivePulse.
So we'll start by thanking all of the hosts who collaborated to pull this event together. All of the Western Region Compact, Oregon, California, Hawaii, Pacific Islands, Montana, and Washington. Thank you all so much for working in collaboration with my office to create an event that is alignment with really pressing issues of the current moment and the vision that we have for community and civic engagement in the West. So we'll just start with a few logistics in today's agenda. We'll open up with a land acknowledgement from Atina, welcome and opening remarks from Dr. John Osorio, a keynote from Dr. Tom Romero, a Q&A right immediately after, a poem by poet, poem from Kathy Jetnell Kilner, a panel discussion that is composed of community advocates and activists from across the Western region, another poem, and we will wrap the day with a Q&A, and then we'll have closing remarks from Atina. And as far as just participant logistics, a few things to consider. Participants should put their questions in the Q&A, not the chat function. So there's two. So make sure to put your question in the Q&A. We'll have 15 minutes for Q&A for Dr. Romero, and then we'll have 30 minutes of Q&A with the panelists. Zoom participants can turn their closed captioning off if you are finding it to be distracting or just not helpful. And if you need any sort of technical assistance, you can contact Piper, and Piper's email is here on the screen. If you want to take a moment to record it, we can also drop it in the chat.
Thank you, Carmen. Let me begin with a land acknowledgement as a step towards our conscious recognition of the place we are in and its indigenous roots. I want to acknowledge that I am a settler on this aina, this land, working at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, located in the Moku Kona and the Ahupua'a of Honolulu. I trace my family's roots to Ohrid, Macedonia. I would like to acknowledge that the aina on which we would be gathering if we were in person is part of the larger territory recognized by Indigenous Hawaiians as their ancestral grandmother, Papahana Moku. I recognize that Her Majesty Queen Liliuokalani yielded the Hawaiian Kingdom and these territories under duress and protest to the United States to avoid the bloodshed of her people. I further recognize that Hawaii remains an illegally occupied state of America. I recognize that each moment that I am in Hawaii, she nourishes and gifts me with the opportunity to breathe her air, to eat from her soils, to drink from her waters, to bathe in her sun, and swim in her oceans, to be kissed by her rains and be embraced by her winds. I further recognize that generations of Indigenous Hawaiians and their knowledge systems shaped Hawaii in sustainable ways that allows me to enjoy these gifts today. For this, I am grateful, and as a settler, I seek to support the varied strategies that the Indigenous peoples of Hawaii are using to protect their land and their communities, and I commit to dedicating time and resources to working in solidarity. At this time, please feel free to use the chat to recognize where you come from or are currently seated. Mahalo. We open this conference with a welcome from Dr. John Osorio, Dean of the School of Hawaiian Knowledge at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. His welcoming chant is for the Valley of Manoa, the University of Hawaii, and its students. He centers his remarks on Hawaiian language and philosophy and reflects deeply on relationships, resilience, respect, and reciprocity, and the current cultural, political, and racial tensions in the United States. His remarks are locally and historically grounded, but deeply relevant for the world today. Dr. Tom Romero, Associate Professor of Law and History, will then provide our conference keynote. Through an evidence-based lens, he will focus on deep racial inequalities in access to clean water in Denver and the Mountain West. Dr. Romero also proposes new roles and new tools for American higher education to meet the promise of equity and opportunity for all. As we proceed through our 3-hour conference, we hope you'll reflect on the places that provide the perspectives shared. The perspectives will move around. Some will be local, others regional, national, and global. And of course, some will be islands. Dr. Osorio?
Language faculty at the Kauai Huilani Center for Hawaiian Language for Manoa, for the University of Hawaii, and for our students. Veli na manoa ua kama'aina, he aina ika ihulao na moku, a moku mai kapava o ke aua ela. Aleka wa wae a he au mala makou hai aloha he kilohana no kane wai ke pili ho I pili aloha me ka ua wa ahila I a hua ho opulu I ke kula o puahia. Puana ke kupu ala leia ke kamanei. Kama ia I kama aina ke aloha. Aloha maano I ka ua tuahine. Hali hali a mai lai ka olu ka hau kani. Kani a ela ia o ka okoho I vai. Ia aina ka ola nei ka ulu lehua. Lehua ke au ka uka lao nani ua po. Po vehe ka bai pea pa lai o vai a ke akua. Aka pahu lai la o aka aka. I ka ua koko ulu a o ka hala. Ua kau, ua holo, ua pae aku. Ua hoi ka ui o manoa. I've been honored and deeply blessed to be on the faculty of the University of Hawaii for almost 30 years. following a very long experimental period as a student, mostly in the Department of History. I'm originally from Hilo, Hawaii, born to two Kanaka Maoli parents, Elroy Lealoha Osorio and Clara Kuulei Kei, now deceased. But since enrolling at Kamehameha Schools here in 1963, I have spent most of my life in Honolulu. I'm also married to a native of Detroit, Mary Dunn, and we have reared six children together, although three of them are still in the house, so maybe I shouldn't use the verb in the past tense. Since 2018, I've been the dean of the School of Hawaiian Knowledge, a college that has two academic units, the Kawaihuelani Center for Hawaiian Language and the Kamakakuokalani Center for Hawaiian Studies, as well as the Native Hawaiian Student Services and the Taro Garden, Kapapalo'i o Kane Wai. I was a full professor of Hawaiian studies before I lost my way and found myself in management. Our school is not large by university standards. About two dozen permanent teaching faculty and perhaps 90 undergraduate majors and another 50 graduate students. But almost all of what we represent has been built in the last 30 years. Our introductory courses, invented by our faculty, teach thousands of undergraduates at this campus and throughout the UH system. The growth of Hawaiian studies has mirrored the growth of Kanaka Maoli students and faculty on the Manoa campus. Over the past 30 years, we have gone from barely 7% of the student body to now more than 17%, qualifying us as a native serving institution. Hawaiian studies and language is only partly responsible for that growth. And in any case, the growing of our numbers has only been a part of what we see as our mission at this university. Through our research of our past, including the vast literature produced by our people in the 19th century, an even vaster archive of songs, chants, dances, wise sayings, stories, and tales, and the physical record of how our people engineered the lands and coastal ponds to feed an astonishing number of people in antiquity, Hawaiian knowledge has become more and more pertinent to other fields of study at the university, particularly in the areas of sustainability and resilience, medicine, public administration and law, language and culture, and even urban and regional planning. But even more than this research, our work is continually centered on society. How do people on an island, especially islands crowded with others, live peacefully and productively? I would like to address that mission of ours today with some reflections on our language and philosophy. And I will begin, perhaps as I should have begun, with this word, this greeting. Aloha. This is a salutation I use most often with emails to colleagues and my students, usually without thinking very much about its meaning or the context of our actual relationships. A few years ago, some of the Hawaiian language professors that I know stopped using that word as a salutation and switched to the less committing word, velina, greetings, because they argued the word aloha is a relational word. It means respect, deep regard, and reciprocity. It means love in the deepest sense that we Kanaka Maoli understand love. To use aloha as an ordinary greeting, I have been told, cheapens the word and its meaning and does not demand a reciprocal respect and regard, which is key to its true meaning. Reciprocity is a pretty good concept when you're dealing with ordinary human beings who have learned to mistrust words like justice and equality. We have a word that approximates those two concepts in our language, kaulike, which literally means to make alike. But unlike the word justice, Kaulike has nothing to do with retribution. It is not, like equality, a state of being. Instead, kaulike is a verb that involves treating someone as though they were like you. Consider other implications of kaulike, making alike, especially what that suggests about our ethics and values. Not simply treating someone fairly, but actually working on conceptualizing another person as being like you, or you being like them. There's an element, isn't there, of intention involved, to make alike, as though you know you aren't alike, but that the relationship nevertheless must be afforded the chance of seeing each other as the same. Sometimes that means expecting the other to behave and think like you do. But very often it means being willing to try and think and behave according to the expectations of the other. Not everyone in America is comfortable with the notion that the stranger or the seemingly strange should be accorded respect and consideration. However, it is not just the strident, openly racist, bullying alt-righter who would find kaulike and aloha problematic, but even the passionate lovers of social justice who insist that everyone in the society, regardless of race, color, or creed, deserves the opportunity to be remade into their own image of what is civilized, educated, productive, and comfortable. There is really no place for contempt, nor even condescension, within the concept of kaulike or aloha, certainly not for someone you have never met and has never been given the opportunity to actually disappoint you. Which, of course, is not to suggest for 1 minute that we Kanaka Maoli do not make judgments about people and groups of people. But when we intentionally practice aloha and kaulike, we are usually trying to understand and appreciate another person on their terms. I do not know if that was the reason why our people mated with all sorts of foreigners, pretty much from the moment those people arrived into our clutches, or if it was just a logical survival strategy in the century when our numbers were reduced by as much as 95% because of introduced diseases. Marriage trends throughout the 19th century, and indeed the 20th century, indicate that we tended not to practice any sort of social selection based on ethnicity or even socioeconomic status. Once married, of course, we all make fun of our in-laws, but then where would be the fun and delight of a relationship without that? I don't know what my father, a well-educated Portuguese Hawaiian, thought of his father-in-law, an American doughboy of German descent from Dayton, Ohio. But I know what my grandfather thought of my dad. He kind of had no use for anyone who didn't love automobiles and know how to fix them. My grandfather's side of the family was much more working class than my father's. But when his children, we went to stay with my mother's family in Kaimuki. We spoke more pidgin, engaged in a humor that might've been more crude than we were accustomed to, and occasionally got into fist fights with each other. I learned early on from my maternal cousins that the more refined behavior expected from me in my paternal household in Hilo, they considered priggish and arrogant. And I learned to love and respect my cousins, despite how differently we thought and behaved. As for my father, I never heard him in my life speak pidgin or condescend to anyone. But when he had the opportunity, he moved our whole family into Keokaha, Hawaiian homelands in Hilo, where we were immediately surrounded by Kanaka Maoli families who made a fraction of our income, lived in decaying houses they could not afford to replace, paid for services with produce and labor when they could, and spoke a pidgin rich in imagery and innuendo. And as children, we were required to assimilate and to learn. I learned how to fight and then learned how to avoid fights because I was not very good at it. And I learned to respect people who really lived with wholly different expectations than I had. As for my father, he simply loved that community and they loved him. I wonder if it isn't through our encounters with people and situations so different from what we previously learned that in the end enables us to love deeply. Difference, after all, seems like a necessary precondition for reciprocity. It might be easier to trust someone who looks normal to us or who seems to think like us, but that relationship might offer fewer opportunities to test yourself and to learn about who you are. And if there is one thing that I have learned for myself, it is that depth is as important an aspect of love as attraction. That's what I find saddest about America's current political tensions. If some of the sociologists are right, the ultra-conservative is about protecting older traditions, familiar communities, and a more recognizable understanding of what for them is the essential America. But the extent to which we now all seem to be engaged in finding shelter among those who think like us and demonizing or rendering irrelevant the rest seems destined to tear the United States apart. And our unwillingness to surrender any kind of advantage that we may hold or suspend, even momentarily, our own convictions in order to repair that relationship again, calls into question whether any of us are capable of aloha. The ugliness and vitriol is coming from many mouths in this country and has been for some time. And when we argue that shouting down the Ku Klux Klan is not the same as being the KKK. While true, I think we are missing the point. Why should anyone fear what neo-Nazis and white supremacists have to say? Have they not always been with us? Oh yes, there were Klansmen at Mississippi in 1964. There were terrorists at Oklahoma City in 1995. The people whose lives were inspired by hate have always lived in the world, and there is only one way to defeat them, by overwhelming them with the truth. Aloha ke akua. God is love. Love is God. Of the words of hate and fury, we must not fear. And when those words turn to the cruel and desperate acts of a Timothy McVeigh, a James Fields, a Saeed Allah, a Donald Trump, I tell you that such evil can never be fully expunged from the human experience. But we can. We must address the things in the world that produce such desperate beings in such ever-growing numbers. The superficial values of modern society that dismiss poverty as someone else's problem, the growing inequities that accept malnutrition and negligible health care as merely unfortunate byproducts of an economy that we don't dare alter for fear of losing our own nest egg. And let's not forget good old-fashioned imperialism. The division of the world into European colonies 150 years ago is still paying dividends of fragmentation of whole societies, dislocation and poverty, violence and sorrow. And who among us has the right to judge the rage of a child brought up in the midst of want and oppression? In the face of all that the world has become, how are we to live? Should we shut out the ugliness and the political and cultural turmoil in America ignore the growing anxiety among the poor that they are still being left to fend for themselves? Or do we finally acknowledge the notion that we are all in this together, all of us on this planet, all of us in need of the thoughtful sharing and reciprocal consideration of aloha? If aloha is reciprocal, it cannot also be transactional. Aloha must be shared, not exchanged. As human beings, we have come to view so many aspects of our lives as transactional, and the society we have created, perhaps at least to this point in history, epitomizes transactions. There's almost nothing anymore that resists the marketplace. Even love itself, as romance and desire, is endlessly exploited in media, always a subtext to even the most violent and degrading films and television programming. More and more, romance and desire are the main plots of our political news. And as we become more jaded to the behavior of the powerful people in America and more disturbed by the nation's selfish, narcissistic directions, we have barred ourselves from experiencing the aloha that transports us out of the places and communities where we are at ease and into places where we might, in our vulnerability, feel something real and meaningful. So I say aloha to you. It is a reminder to all of us that love is divine. Aloha ke akua. And we are nothing if we are not also aloha. We may certainly live our lives for nothing, but it is not what our kupuna, our ancestors wanted for us. Wa'ola no ka ko iki aloha. We live in love. So let us live, setting aside hate and fear, committing ourselves body and soul to creating things that alleviate suffering and want. We should sing and paint and write of the magnificence of love and compassion in the world. We should risk our lives and reputations for the oppressed, wherever they are, and love regardless. Aloha.
Thank you so much for your beautiful comments, Dr. Osorio. And we now move on to our keynote brought to us by Dr. Tom Romero. The title of today's keynote is The Color of Water Redux, Observations of a Brown Buffalo on Resilience and Responsibility for Racial and Environmental Justice. This keynote is situated in the space between centering community wisdom and institutionalizing and implementing the knowledge that lives in communities of color in the context of policy. So we are thrilled to have Dr. Romero speaking on the politics of water in the Denver area. And afterward, just a reminder, we'll have a Q&A. So please do, if while you are watching the keynote, please do place your questions for Dr. Romero in the Q&A function so that I can collect them and pose them to him after the keynote is complete. So thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Romero. Let's do the keynote.
Hello, my name is Tom Romero, and I am a professor of law and history at the University of Denver. I'm also the founding director of the University of Denver's Interdisciplinary Research Institute for the Study of Inequality, otherwise known as iRise. And it is my distinct pleasure to be here today to talk with you all about the particular responsibility that institutions of higher education have when it comes to thinking about resilience and empowerment in the face of racial and economic and environmental justice. My talk today is really centered and built upon my own scholarship. A few years ago, I wrote an article urging critical race theorists and water law and policy practitioners to engage in critical conversation and collaboration around racial disparities in the ownership, distribution, and access to usable water in the developing as well as developed world. Invoking Chicana X movement lawyer Oscar Zeta Acosta's activist Brown Buffalo moniker, I specifically argued that water law and policy needed to incorporate a racial justice lens in its decision-making. Now, this is really important. Here in the Rocky Mountain North American West and Intermountain North American West, water buffaloes is used to describe all those who work on water law, water policy, and certainly the water practitioners. And it's done as a means to highlight this exclusive group, but this elite group who really are the king and the queen makers for this part of the country. So this was part of a larger conversation, as well as a movement to center water as not only a key part of our understanding of environmental justice, but as perhaps the most important 21st century battleground in the elusive quest for racial justice in the United States. So my talk that I'm giving to you today is really coming back to my observations as a brown buffalo to think about what does the color of water look like in terms of our work around resilience and responsibility in the face of racial and environmental justice. So my time with you is a series of observations to help us understand this larger role. Using the vital resource of water at the center of my analysis, I have organized my observations into four parts to begin answering this question. Part one helps to set the context for understanding the human and environmental connections we are examining today. Part two describes the tension of agency, reliability, and trust in fundamentally addressing the issues of climate or environmental or water justice. Connected to issues of institutional and systemic discrimination, part two is going to look a little bit about the historical manifestation and the deep-rooted nature of these inequalities connected to the larger environmental concerns. Part three then turns to how and in what ways you might consider our work in partnership and collaboration with racial and climate justice groups. Finally, part four turns to highlighting a new tool to further this work. I specifically want us to think about what are some of the tools that we have available, not just in higher education, but to connect higher education to the larger movement of those that are doing this work on the ground. All right. So let's start here with the first part where I set up the larger context for understanding the human and environmental connections that are a part of our conversation around resilience and responsibility for racial and environmental justice. In 2016, health regulators discovered per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances, otherwise known as PFAS, in the water supplies of the Colorado towns of Fountain and Security Whitefield. The PFAS levels the regulators found exceeded the EPA's new 2006 health advisory levels, raising immediate concerns about these chemical compounds' bioaccumulate and the fact that they remain in the environment, including the human body, for long periods of time. Health regulators, water suppliers, and residents of these Colorado towns would come to learn that the source of these chemicals was the firefighting foam used for decades to extinguish training fuel fires at the nearby Peterson Air Force Base. Unseen, but with deadly impact, the fire suppressant had entered the drinking water supply. Not long after this discovery, Latinx community activists in the Denver metropolitan area raised their own concerns when Colorado's Public Health Regulatory Agency discovered PFAS in the water supply in this community. One among thousands of complaints that began to be lodged nationwide, the discovery of PFAS, or forever chemicals as they came to be popularly known, their existence in the drinking supply in Denver symbolized the dramatic impact of the fire suppressant chemical compound in the water of racially minoritized communities. Linked to cancers, liver and kidney damage, high cholesterol, low infant birth weight, and other ailments, including immune system disorders, The forever chemicals exacerbate already pre-existing health inequities existing in the nation's most vulnerable and segregated communities. As the social determinants of health literature has shown, the impact of PFAS is one of a long list of environmental harms, including around clean water and clean air, born on racially minoritized communities that are directly connected and exacerbated by systemic practices of discrimination, such as the quality of one's housing, access to employment, or high-performing schools. These all begin to impact a person's health long before a clinical diagnosis of a disease. This understanding helps us know that it will take a commitment from all parts of society, not just those in public health, to achieve the public health goal of health equity when confronting climate justice concerns. Of course, the COVID-19 pandemic has put an even more precise point on these challenges. If you look at this chart here, you see the disparate impact that COVID-19 has had in particular on racially minoritized communities. The immediacy, of course, of this conversation became amplified and as the world was literally on fire as a result of the raging interconnected pandemics of COVID-19, racial violence, and the wildfires precipitated by climate change. In each case, massive and endemic institutional and systemic racial disparities made obvious all the ways that racial minoritized communities disproportionately bore the brunt of economic dislocation, deadly health outcomes, and physical as well as psychological dislocation. Now, as we move to the rapid distribution of COVID-19 vaccines, scientists have announced how deep-rooted environmental racism is, particularly when connected to these forever chemicals. In our water justice context, scientists in December of 2020 raised the alarm that high levels of PFAS exposure could make individuals have weaker responses to vaccination, only deepening inequities exposed by the global pandemic. So this is our context. This is the world in which we live, and certainly this is the world in which we must confront. In part two here, I want to describe the tension of agency, reliability, and trust in fundamentally addressing these issues. Often denied access to resources, reliable information, and substantive governance, racially minoritized communities continue to bear the brunt of institutional and systemic discrimination that has happened over the course of decades. I specifically turned to my own work in Northeast Denver, Colorado, to uncover this area's history of racial inequality when it comes to water justice. So particularly here in the United States, many Americans take water for granted. The United States has one of the most developed and comprehensive systems of water infrastructure in the world, with massive dams and reservoirs, modern groundwater pumps, billions of miles of water and sewage pipes, sophisticated wastewater treatment plants, and a broad regulatory framework over industrial and hazardous waste. In turn, few Americans realize how much water they consume every day, nor do a vast majority have to wonder each and every day whether that water might make them sick. Of course, as Flint, Michigan demonstrated in the last decade, communities of color in the United States routinely lack access to safe drinking water and adequate sanitation. Government authorities actively have kept this information in terms of the quality of the water and or actively have prevented communities of color of taking control over the type of water that they are able to get to their communities. So we have a couple of different challenges that Flint has exposed. Decades upon decades of systemic discrimination that has led to unequal water infrastructure that is reinforced by a lack of access to water governance in particular. A relatively recent case in Zanesville, Ohio provides another insight into the racist dimensions of water development. Zanesville is situated about 50 miles east of Columbus, Ohio, off a major east-west interstate highway. Various governmental units, including three charged with water delivery in the area and its surrounding townships, had carried out a policy, a pattern, and a practice of denying water service to the only predominantly African-American neighborhood in the area, Coal Run. Evidence in the case revealed that over a 35-year period, the city rejected or disregarded numerous requests from Coal Run residents to connect to existing water and sewage lines that bounded and bordered the Coal Run neighborhood. At the same time, the single government agency charged with water development in the city actively pursued funding and construction of a host of water projects in the city and surrounding areas into the 1990s, but never to Coal Run. Most egregiously, while the city can routinely deny individual requests from African-American residents to connect to existing water and sewage lines, it purposely routed these same water and sewage connections around the Coal Run neighborhood to adjacent communities that were predominantly white residents. Exacerbating matters even further was the fact that Black neighborhoods sat atop an abandoned coal mine that contaminated the groundwater supply. Instead of getting water from a well, Coal Run residents had to catch water off their roofs, melt snow, or truck in using barrels, pool liners, and every other manner of container. The water that was gathered went into cisterns, though these cisterns would often fill with bugs and worms and rodents, and animals would crawl into them to die. So all of this, the history of Zanesville, certainly what we know of Flint, some of what I'm going to talk about in terms of what's happening in Colorado, is connected to a water infrastructure and a project that is deeply embedded in Jim Crow, right? But Jim Crow in ways that is different from the ways that we think about it, most explicitly. And I want us to think about the ways that we think of water, right? Water often just sort of makes it magically into our taps, right? But those underground pipes, those cisterns, even those water tanks, right, are markers of racial segregation, right, of what I call a colorblind legal regime. Of course, this has been documented all over the place. New Jersey, Dallas, Texas, Chicago, Tennessee, Georgia, all over the United States, right? This regime is connected, right, to the ways that water and color and the color line in the United States in particular are intricately connected. Now here in Colorado and the neighborhood that I'm looking at, Northeast Denver, one of the communities that I'm looking at is situated within a real important context. One that is connected to, on one side is a series of oil refineries, and on the other side is a war munitions plant, right? So the context and the ultimate result is that it has contaminated the water supply. And so this gives you some sense of what we're talking about in terms of contamination. You have one irrigation ditch that is 99.9% refined gasoline. You have, over the course of decades, public health agencies that are trying to bring an educational approach to this, right? Trying to help the community understand, what this means. But of course, this is done through science, through technical briefs. And ultimately, with this real contempt for the communities. And I sort of highlight what you see here in the right, right? Really sort of public agencies, those that have power in the area, the water supply agencies are basically saying, if you don't like it, move, right? But of course, what this means is that this is the most affordable housing in the area. This is the only place where people, particularly communities of color, can live. So this is really kind of the we think about part two, right, is this tension, right? This tension between who gets to own knowledge, what do you do with that knowledge, and how you use that knowledge ultimately to transform what is really a racial and environmental justice issue. So part three here gives some observations and how we can turn to how we consider our work in partnership and collaboration with racial and climate justice groups. Using my own Color of Water and Colorado project as an example, I give a sense of the ways that we can leverage the resources of higher education to link these groups and government regulatory agencies in collaborative partnership around climate justice. Part of a larger body of community engaged research, I will explore how this project works to raise and thereby center the voices and experiences of racially minoritized communities in civic as well as legal discourse. So as a brown buffalo thinking and working about these issues in one of the nation's epicenters of water law, I have worked to connect, collaborate, and sometimes collide key stakeholders through my Color of Colorado and Water Law Project, or CCWL, which is housed at the University of Denver's Interdisciplinary Research Institute for the Study of Inequality. Rooted in the insights of community-engaged research and practice literature, the CCWL works to identify and apply best practices in ways that local and state government authorities, as well as institutions of higher education, build effective and sustainable partnerships with underserved communities around water ownership and access. Particularly as government agencies across the United States are grappling with ways to meaningfully integrate an environmental justice lens while remaining within regulatory laws and guidelines, its lessons, I hope, on governments and civic engagement will be applicable on a broad array of issues from proposed development and infrastructure projects, community safety and policing, access to affordable housing, and educational equity, to name but a few. Of course, all of these are connected to the larger issue of environmental and racial justice. Now, the area of Denver that I'm working in is an especially compelling area to study and learn about government engagement with racially minoritized communities. Starting as a trading post in the 1860s, the area emerged as a hub of commercial and industrial activity by the beginning of World War II, as polluting petroleum refineries, tow grain elevators, manufacturing and freight hauling were sited in close proximity to very affordable and modest homes. East of the community, as I alluded to, the Rocky Mount Arsenal was founded in 1942, and it was used to manufacture chemical warfare agents, including mustard gas and incendiary munitions. Following the war, the arsenal manufactured the nerve agents VX and GB, also called sarin. Rocket fuel was blended on site for the Titan and Delta missile operations. Shell Oil leased the property and manufactured agricultural pesticides in the complex from 1952 through 1982, when all government and private manufacturing ceased on the property. In 1987, the arsenal was placed in the national priorities list of Superfund sites. Heavy manufacturing and industry continue to grow in the area. And today, Suncor Energy owns and operates the largest petroleum refinery in Colorado and one of the largest in the Rocky Mountain region. And the map that you see here just sort of gives you a sense of the community, which is bounded by the red there, the community, which is bounded by the Superfund sites to the right, the oil refineries on the left-hand corner of the screen, and of course, the groundwater and the drinking water supply, kind of in the blue. And this is where your racially minoritized, particularly Latinx communities, live in the region. Now, of course, what this has meant is just a constant contamination of the water supply, something that is happening quite repeatedly in the area. And of course, connecting it back to the PFAS or the forever chemicals, right? This has meant that the drinking water, right, that the residents have in this area is constantly contaminated and constantly subject to questions, right, about how it's impacting the area's approximately 48% Latinx population. And beginning in 1996, Commerce City began to grow north, building largely residential housing developments, golf courses, and related infrastructure. The result has been a city that is geographically and residentially divided along racialized and income lines, with working class or poor Latinx communities living in the older, higher density housing stock in the shadows of the refineries and other heavy manufacturing operations. Mostly white, more affluent residents live in single family planned developments and parts of the municipality far removed from these activities. Especially for Latinx residents living in Commerce City, Commerce City's older housing stocks, there's a strong urgency to address present day water and air contamination, which are rooted in historical systemic inequities. Collectively, it's contributed to a related sense of powerlessness to get good data, understand the nature of the problem, or whom to partner with to arrive at long-term solutions. So the Carlisle People's Alliance, or COPA, has become the primary racial justice group working in this space. After ongoing engagement with the community through conversations at their doors, COPA discovered the 12 wells that distribute water to over 50,000 households in the area are contaminated with these PFAS. So COPA has been organizing to demand that the Adams County Water Board take action to ensure that everyone has access to clean drinking water and have access to a transparent process for fixing water contamination in the issues in the area. So what has this meant from the perspective then of higher education? A couple of years ago, through the Color of Water in Colorado Law Project through IRISE, IRISE and myself partnered with the Colorado Department of Public Health and the Environment. to start working with COPA to inject ourselves into this past history and present reality to identify the most pressing water and air quality concerns being experienced by Commerce City's racially minoritized residents. Working with iRise faculty, postdoctoral fellows, and students, the Colorado Department of the Public Health has partnered with COPA to identify answers to the following questions. What are the recent and long-term concerns regarding water and air quality of those living and working in the area? What structural and institutional challenges and barriers, both public and private, exist to getting these concerns addressed? And what are substantive meaning and meaningful pathways by which community organizations, local and state government agencies, and institutions of higher education can empower underserved communities to develop research questions and share data and knowledge in government decision-making process? And ultimately, how can a call to action across sectors be produced to address both short-term problems and long-term institutional practices contributing to housing, health, education, employment, and economic inequality? So this is really at the core of the partnership, right? And really this is in some ways is thinking about how do we center, right, institutions of higher education to help bring together and be a nexus to community racially-based organizations and those government agencies that are most charged with responding in particular to environmental as well as larger systemic and institutional concerns. All right, so part four. I turn in this part now to highlighting a new tool to help think about how we can further this work. Specifically, and this is something I'm proposing and developing in iRise, I propose that municipal water suppliers should adopt racial impact statements as part of their standard operations. Modeled after the widespread use of environmental impact statements, I argue that racial impact statements provide a powerful new platform to raise the voices of water justice advocates fighting the multiple fire water threatening their communities. So let me give you a quick overview of what this looks like. From a law and from a policy perspective, right? We have a couple different ways we can think about the protection of communities, right, that are at the center of this. One is through regulation, state and national legislation. It can be done at the level of the water supplier. But what do we know about all of this? At least that from a jurisprudential standpoint, the legal solutions are limited. From a regulatory and policy standpoint, they take years to enact. They require really good relationships, right, with local community. And of course, just as we've seen in the last 4 or 5 years, new administrations can come in and completely dismantle policy, right? Setting really the work back years, if not decades. So one of the things I want to focus then on is that if there are these limitations, what can we do, particularly at a local level, that can be of an immediate impact and that could be of much longer term endurance? And here I want to suggest and talk about something that institutions of higher education can help develop, you know, particularly law schools, particularly political science departments, any department that might be engaged in the issue of public policy, right, can help to develop these statements and use these in particular for local government. And so what are racial impact statements? This is a tool to evaluate potential disparities of proposed legislation or policy or particular policy that's considered to be applied prior to adoption and implementation. Now, analogous to a fiscal or an environmental impact statement, they assist legislators and policymakers to detect unforeseen policy ramification. Policymakers can then modify legislation or regulation that would worsen existing racial disparities. So we've seen these be used actually in the last 5 to 10 years as a result of criminal justice reform. States like Iowa, Connecticut, Florida, Oregon, New Jersey have implemented mechanisms for the preparation and consideration of racial impact statements in terms of what criminal justice reform would look like, right, in terms of its implementation. So from environmental justice perspective or a racial justice perspective, right, racial impact statements would require legislators, we require policymakers, we require civil service bureaucrats, as they're considering a particular policy, to begin to think about what that policy would look like in particular on racially minoritized communities, right? And then be able to come up with good reasons, right? Why that policy should either be implemented, or most importantly, how that policy in terms of its implementation can be adapted and refined, right? In order to have, to lessen and mitigate the impact on racially minoritized communities. Of course, what this requires is the existence of good data. On February 24th of this year, the operator of the major refinery in this area in Denver, Suncor, has started to accept the signups for a notification system that will go live on June 1st of 2021 that alerts residents about any incidents that might cause concern, be it a gas flare or a belch of smoke from a smokestack or a leach of chemicals into the water supply. Now, this is the result of a $9 million settlement the company agreed to with state environmental authorities nearly a year ago, following years of excessive releases of sulfur dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, hydrogen cyanide, nitrogen oxides, and more. The company will also send out alerts about planned events that could have impacts on roads around the plant, like firefighter training, which would also include use of some of those forever chemicals. Now, this is a small step in what's been a longer and complicated history of industrial operations in the area, right? It's connected to racial impact statements because this is the type of data that policymakers can now begin to look at and to use within the alert system. It can find out who's being alerted, when they're being alerted, why they're not being alerted. We can talk about the ways then that this data can also be connected to a health regulatory agency like the Colorado Department of Public Health, right? That can work with the Colorado People's Alliance to make sure that the rollout and the connection to this work is happening on a real-time basis. So ultimately, as we consider resilience and responsibility as a climate justice issue, my talk today is meant to demonstrate the vital role we in higher education play in increasing the capacity of local and state government and racial justice organizations to partner to do one of really four things. One, to partner and collaborate early in engaging community residents to raise, share, inform, and develop meaningful data on issues impacting their community. Two, to reinforce cooperation among government agencies, understand communities and underserved communities to create long-term trust and sustainable engagement. Three, to identify pathways for government, civil society organizations, and partnerships to utilize and deploy the expertise and resources of higher education to address racial and related social determinants of health inequities. And four, to develop new and innovative methods and tools addressed to a wide range of stakeholders, including civil servants, educators, NGOs, and youth leaders. I started this talk today as revisiting my Color of Water article in context of the current PFAS crisis in the global pandemic. Water and its related infrastructure is not merely blue. With the help of law and millions of policy decisions, our water infrastructure and who has and doesn't have access to clear and clean water helps to mark and identify white, Black, Latino, Asian, and Indigenous communities. It creates the conditions for development or lack thereof for individuals, property owners, and entrepreneurs from each of these groups. Water and its larger connection to climate change and climate justice, perhaps most importantly, represents power and inequity in a racially diverse world. True, we are all connected by water, but so too are we divided by some of our most fiercely contested legal and policy disputes. We must be vigilant and aware of the color lines that serve to dam and thereby thwart justice. As brown buffaloes, all in higher education, the realities of climate change and its undeniable connection to real and durable color lines in our contemporary multiple pandemic world demand we must act to meet the moment. I want to thank you all for your time today, and I'm looking forward to the conversation.
Hi, Tom. How are you?
Doing great. Good afternoon, everyone, or good morning, for depending on where you're at.
It's wonderful to see you. Thank you so much for the keynote and the critical work that you do. So we don't have a whole lot of time, so I'm just going to jump right into questions.
Great.
So the first question that we received from the audience, what is the scientific process, the physiological process inside the body that increases cancer through the pollution that the pollutants in water and waterways that BIPOC communities are ultimately exposed to? And there's an acronym here that I don't, PFAFs. So et cetera from the PFAFs. Do you, maybe there's a clarifying.
Yeah, the PFAFs, I think.
The PFAFs.
So, yeah,
the PFAFs, yes. So if you know what that is.
Fluoride chemicals, correct.
Yes, yeah. So what is the chemical process that causes cancers in the body?
Well, so here's where you know, certainly the limitations of my knowledge, I think, are evident. Even though my students and colleagues will call me doctor, my PhD is in history, and I'm certainly trained as a lawyer. So I won't pretend to be able to explain clearly or cogently, what the actual physiological process is. What I can say is that these sorts of chemicals, right, have like many other industrial chemicals, right, tend to work with the human body in very unanticipated ways, right, and ultimately create sort of problems of the body to be able to respond to pathogens in particular. So, like I said, I don't want to comment too much more beyond that, but. I think certainly any medical doctors, public health professionals who are deeper in the field, particularly when it comes to chemical pollutants, might be able to provide some really good insight into that.
Absolutely. Thank you for that answer. So the next question is about infrastructure. Did the infrastructure to transport water start water to BIPOC communities? Was it always awful? Or was the breakdown in, or the occurrence of pollutants in waterways, is that something that happened over time?
So that's a great question. One that I can speak from a couple of different contexts. You have the bit of the context from Denver. I also mentioned Zanesville, Ohio in my talk today. And what I can say from a sort of a general perspective is that where we've seen the development of water infrastructure, and particularly in the United States, it's a phenomenon that happened in the late 19th, early 20th century. Prior to that time, water infrastructure was privatized. And so what we see in the United States is in the developed world, we're seeing the developing world, right? So only those that have access to resources were able to pay those rates for private suppliers. Certainly as cities began to rise in prominence, as they began to increase their tax bases in the late 19th, early 20th century, cities in the United States, many cities, not all, began to take over and buy some of those private water supplies. And so that in some sense democratized, right, water access. But I will say with the large caveat is that a lot of water development happened in the newer parts of the city, right? Which are oftentimes more affluent. And so in a place like Denver, for instance, we saw what were the more affordable parts of the city that had emerged in the late 19th century, which oftentimes first started from immigration from Eastern and Southern Europe, which then ultimately moved, sort of emerged in the context of Denver and Colorado as Latinx communities. They had no water infrastructure, right? So there was a lack of water infrastructure in those sorts of neighborhoods. What we're seeing more contemporaneously is, particularly as cities grow, as there have been movements in cities to back to cities, some of these neighborhoods that had some of the oldest and maybe most poorly defined water infrastructure, they've been updated, right? But what that has done is push communities of color out to the margins, right, of cities, to the metropolitan areas. And so their communities of color in particular are moving into the parts of cities that have some of the most oldest and outdated water infrastructure, which is gonna require updating. Mm-hmm. So it's a great question, and one that we see in particular this really important push-pull to where people are living, and it's certainly connected to the history and some of the history that I described.
Yeah, and thank you so much for elucidating the ways in which city planning, the movement of bodies, waves of immigration into cities impacts who has access to just basic needs such as water, clean drinking water. So the next question is about the designation of a Superfund site. So the participant has heard of Superfund sites. Could you explain a little bit more about what they are? How does a site get on a list to be a Superfund site? What is the process for of decision making and designation as a Superfund site? And how are governments responsible for cleaning them up?
Yeah, another great question. We have whole courses in the law school around this, and this really is part of a larger set of national laws, right, that emerged with the National Environmental Act in the early 1970s. In 1980, Congress established the Comprehensive Environmental Response Compensation Liability Act, otherwise known as CERCLA. And so this is when we call something a Superfund, we're referring specifically to CERCLA. And that allows the Environmental Protection Agency to clean up contaminated sites. Most importantly, and I think this is the real important piece, it forces the parties responsible for the contamination to either perform cleanups or reimburse the government for EPA-led cleanup work. And so this is the real sort of cost-paying mechanism, because these Superfund sites are extremely expensive to clean up, sometimes to the point that it's almost impossible to clean up because sites are so contaminated. And rather than become sites fit for human use, they oftentimes are then turned into sites that are allowable for more intermittent human use. And oftentimes you'll see wildlife areas that are designated coming out of some of these CERCLA Superfund type of sites. It's a pretty complex process to determine what becomes a Superfund site. It's certainly connected to the level and the comprehensiveness of the contamination. It's connected to identifying the parties that can ultimately pay for the cleanup. So when I referenced the Rocky Mountain Arsenal in Denver, in the Commerce City area, the responsible parties were actually private companies, the private companies that were involved in the fertilizer business, and the U.S. Army, actually, that paid all the costs for that Superfund cleanup.
Great. And so thank you for that explanation of what constitutes a Superfund site. I think we have time for two more questions, and they're coming in through my phone, and I'm getting more and more. So the next question is actually about the EPA. Often a hapless bureaucracy, or in the last administration, a corrupt one, seems to address almost nothing of substance. What are your thoughts on a well-funded, nationwide, BIPOC-led environmental justice NGO to research and prioritize Superfund-type sites on or near reservations and other minority communities to pressure the EPA to finally do its assigned job?
Yeah, great question and great idea. I think what this question really speaks to is the variety of different potential avenues, right, to engage. There's certainly, as I mentioned in the talk, right, any sort of EPA solution is potentially time and term limited, right? As a result of who's in power and who's in the administration. And so I think one of the things that this I certainly suggest is how do we galvanize local power? I always sort of talk about all politics is local, all power is local, right? And you know, what really are the some of the communities that I've focused on, right? The agencies, the government agencies that have the most power are local government agencies. And in this context, water suppliers and water developers. And Colorado is a perfect sort of case study in that. California is another perfect case study. This question I think speaks to particular local context in which the federal government has a huge role, right? And would be considered either the landowner or holding, you know, the land in trust for others. So I think that is definitely something to think about is, you know, what could exist at the national level to, I don't know if it's the EPA, if it's working with the Bureau of Indian Affairs, the Bureau of Land Management, but to really put pressure on those sorts of agencies, right? And in a lens around environmental justice. And I'll leave it sort of there with the final observation that I know many of my colleagues in law, in particular, that are really doing work around environmental justice have been tapped and brought into the current administration to begin to develop a comprehensive strategy, at least from the government level, that would be able to engage, I think, in the ways that the question suggests.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Romero. And we have one more. As identified during the introduction, many of us are settlers on unceded lands. How do you recommend that we begin the conversation and develop a relationship with the community when we are perceived as others?
So again, another great question, and one that I'll put in context of both some of the work that we're doing at the University of Denver, some of the work that I'm familiar about. So the context I'm thinking of is higher education. I think that most importantly, for those of us that are connected to these institutions of higher education, it is that recognition from the very, very top and that acknowledgement, right, from the very, very top that we are settlers, right? And in some cases, we have contributed, right, to the violent displacement of Indigenous peoples from these lands. Mm-hmm. And then the second sort of piece then is what then do you create, right, as an institutional set of partnerships, whether it's through memorandums of understanding, right, with various sort of Indigenous or First Nations or Native American nations. We at the University of Denver have developed a Native American Community Advisory Board that does include membership from the Arapaho, the Cheyenne, the Ute, which are the historic Native American nations that were part of what is now the lands that we call Colorado. We are in the process of developing different sorts of memorandums of understanding with those groups. We actually just recently have partnered with the University of Calgary, and University of Calgary has shared with us the ways that they built into their landscaping plan a world view that was in which settlers and Indigenous values could communicate through shared understandings of what landscape development would look like on that campus. And so I guess the most important observation here, I think, in relation to the question is, what has your institution done to center as co-equal partners and collaborators Indigenous peoples in this work? And University of Denver has done some of this work. I'll say we have a lot more work to go in this regard. But I think one of the things that I've been hearing and certainly been trying to help facilitate in the ways that I can at my university is exactly sort of changing our mindset to one in which we act sort of solely as settlers to one in which we need to act and always as partners and co-collaborators with our Indigenous and Native American partners. And in many cases, let them lead. And particularly for these settler institutions like mine at the University of Denver, That's really hard. That's really hard. And I think one of the most encouraging signs that I've seen from our chancellor and our provost in particular is they've begun to, as we've engaged in this work, to recalibrate their expectations that this is a relationship that also in which they need to decenter themselves and also to understand that this is work that takes time and in fact never ends, right? And is sort of constantly changing.
Yes, absolutely. And I love ending on that note. So institutional and individual accountability and centering Indigenous voice in environmental and racial justice movements is absolutely critical. And so with that, we must wrap up our Q&A session. Thank you so much, Dr. Romero, for everything that you do and for joining us today and gracing us with your knowledge. Please keep up the amazing work. And so for our audience today, we will have a poem from Kathy Jitnell Kilner, and then we will transition into our community activist panel. Thank you so much, Dr. Romero.
Thank you, everyone.
Sister of ice and snow, I'm coming to you from the land of my ancestors, from atolls, sunken volcanoes, undersea descent of sleeping giants.
Sister of ocean and sand, I welcome you to the land of my ancestors, to the land where they sacrificed their lives to make mine possible, to the land of survivors.
I'm coming to you from the land my ancestors chose. Ailungkainan, Marshall Islands, a country more sea than land.
I welcome you to Kadatliknunan, Greenland, the biggest island on earth.
With me, I bring these shells that I picked from the shores of Biginni Atoll and Runid Dome.
In my hand, I hold these rocks picked from the shores of Nuuk, the foundation of the land I call my home.
With these shells, I bring with me a story of long ago. Two sisters frozen in time on the island of Wuyai. One magically turned to stone. The other who chose that life to be rooted by her sister's side. To this day, the two sisters can be seen by the edge of the reef. A lesson in permanence.
With these rocks, I bring a story told countless times. A story about Sesuma Amna, mother of the sea, who lives in a cave at the bottom of the ocean. This is a story about the guardian of the sea. She sees the greed in our hearts, the disrespect in our eyes. Every whale, every stream, every iceberg are her children. When we disrespect them, she gives us what we deserve, a lesson in respect. Do we deserve the melting ice, the hungry polar bears coming to our islands, or the colossal icebergs hitting these waters with rage? From one island to another,
I ask for solutions. From one island to another,
I ask for your problems.
Let me show you the tide, coming for us faster than we'd like to admit. Let me show you airports underwater, bulldozed reefs, blasted sands, and plans to build new atolls, forcing land from an ancient rising sea, forcing us to imagine turning ourselves to stone.
Can you see a glacier's groan, the weight of the world's heat? I wait for you, here on the land of my ancestors, heart heavy with a continuous thirst for solutions. As I watch this land change while the world remains silent.
Sister of ice and snow, I come to you now in grief.
Mourning landscapes that are always forced to change. First through wars inflicted on us.
Then through nuclear waste dumped in our waters.
On our ice.
And now,
sister of ocean and sand, I offer you these rocks the foundation of my home. May the same unshakable foundation connect us, make us stronger than these colonizing monsters that still to this day devour our lives. The very same beasts that now decide who should live, who should die.
Sister of ice and snow, I offer you these shells and the story of the two sisters as testament, as decoration, that despite what we are told, we will not leave. We will choose stone. We will choose to be rooted to this reef forever. From these islands,
we ask for solutions.
From these islands,
we ask, we demand that the world see beyond.
ACs, SUVs, their pre-packaged convenience, their oil slick dreams.
Beyond the belief that tomorrow will never happen, that this is merely an inconvenient truth.
Let me bring my home to yours.
Let's watch as Miami, New York, Shanghai, Amsterdam, London, Rio de Janeiro, and Osaka try to breathe underwater. You think you have decades before your home falls beneath tides?
We have years. We have months before you sacrifice us again. Before you watch from your TV screens and computer screens to see if we will still be breathing while you do nothing.
My sister, I offer you these rocks as a reminder that our lives matter more than their power. That life in all forms demands the same respect we all give to money.
That these issues will affect each and every one of us. None of us is immune.
And that each and every one of us has to decide if we will rise.
I dreamt of a dead shark. My family and I were having a party, and my mother asked me to check the oven. When I opened it, there it was, massive, gray leathered skin, jaw wide open, like a steel trap. I dreamt of eating a shark. When I woke up, I met my mother in the hallway. I told her about my dream, how it felt foreboding. Together, we went outside, and that's when we found the world flooded. Water everywhere. Our neighbors wandering outside, mourning days on their faces. Homes inundated, families evacuated, sent to sleep on classroom floors in the nearby elementary school. My family and I are descendants of the Rebego clan, the shark clan. Known to control the waves with roro chants, it was said they could turn the tides with the sound of their voices. They sang songs to the sharks encircling their canoes. We were connected to these white-tipped, slick-bodied ancestors who carved the waters. We would never have eaten them. In the Marshall Islands, I teach Pacific literature. My students read the stories once told by our ancestors around a coconut husk fire. So what stories are we telling ourselves today? What legends are we throwing into the fire? What are we burning? Will future generations recite this story by heart, hand over chest? Maybe in one legend, it'll start by saying, in the beginning was water. Water flooding our homes, our land, and now our only underground reservoir, what we call a freshwater lens, shaped like the front of an eyeball, nestled deep in coral, feeding on rainwater. It watches us, burning and angry. It is vindictive. It poisons us with salt, leaving us dry and thirsty. Over 6,000 miles away from my island home is the U.S. state of Minnesota. I've read that Minnesota, like the Marshalls, is simultaneously drowning and thirsting. In 2007, 24 Minnesota counties received drought designation, while 7 counties declared flood disasters. In 2012, 55 Minnesota counties received drought designation, while 11 counties declared flood emergencies. Climate scientists warn of intensified heat. They say this heat will threaten Minnesota's Great North Woods, a forest nearly 12,000 years old. Scientists predict that the mixed hardwood and conifer forest will follow glaciers and retreat north by as much as 300 miles in the next century. I imagine a hardwood forest, a hardwood tree, ancient and weary, heaving its tree trunk body to its new home where it will forever mourn its roots. In this legend, identify the theme, the moral, the message. What have we learned? Have we learned anything? What is the archetype of a monster and a hero? Are they one and the same? Here's another story of a tree. On one of our atolls known as Kwajalein, there is said to be a flowering tree that bloomed and grew from the reef itself, a Wutilomer tree. It was said its magical white petals would fall into the water and then blossom into flying fish. On a lazy Sunday, my cousin and I lay side by side on my auntie's veranda, sun drying our skin, and together we dreamed an organization dedicated to people like us, to young people like us, who leapt blind and joyful into water, willing ourselves wings to fly, who dared to dream of a world where forests and islands stay rooted, who believe this world is worth fighting for. I still nightmare of dead sharks, but I'd rather dream. I'd rather imagine our next generation, how their voices will turn the tides, how our underground reservoir will drink in their chants, how they will speak shark songs and fluent fish, how they will leap, petal soft, beautiful, unafraid, into the water before blossoming to fly.
Well, Kathy, I'm not sure if Kathy's here today, but thank you, Kathy, for that incredible, powerful work. So next, I would like to introduce our panelists. Today's panel discussion. So today's panel discussion is titled like the event, "The Promise of Full Participation, Resiliency, and Responsibility for Racial and Environmental Justice." Today's conversation engages the intersection of Indigenous knowledge and critical race theory and notes that Indigenous identities and cultures predate racial categorization. Therefore, there are Black, Brown, and white passing Indigenous people, all carrying pre-colonial culture and knowledge and living with the politics and consequences of racism. Today's panelists work for social change by centering diverse Indigenous lenses and knowledges. They do so the critical work of addressing and dismantling the harmful effects of European and American imperialism while uplifting and empowering their communities. Today's conversation is rooted in the felt theories of everyday life and the profundity of the wisdom of lived experience. It is rooted in accountability to the fact that if one is not Native, then one is a guest on the lands that are home to the Indigenous peoples of their region and part of a national project that is based in occupying and exploiting natural resources and systems in the uplifting of systems and institutions that disempower those who originally called those lands home. Additionally, on a base level, the current climate crisis is integrally tied to settler colonialism, white supremacy, and modern capitalism, all predicated on enslavement, genocide, and extractive practices that harm Black, Brown, Indigenous communities the most and slowly make the earth uninhabitable for everyone. We are thrilled to have these esteemed guests with us today, great innovators in the fight for environmental justice, which must, to be truly justice, center Indigenous voices and ways of being. So I would like to start by introducing Dr. Carla Bird of Blackfeet Community College. Carla will be representing our higher ed leadership. Sadie Olson, our student activist. Tristan Orozco, our public health advocate and community partner. and Robin Saha, a policy advocate. And you can all turn on your cameras so we can see you. Hi, Tristan. Hi, Carla.
Hello.
So wonderful to see you. I see Sadie is here. Sadie, can you turn on your camera? And Robin, I see you. So Sadie will probably join us. Oh, hi, Sadie. There you are. Great. All right, everybody's here. Okay, so for the audience, we're going to, each panelist is going to give a brief presentation on their work and the lens that informs their work. And then we're going to jump into conversation because goodness knows there's a lot to talk about and we don't have enough time. I haven't really, Tristan, do you want to start us off since your window is right next to mine?
Sure. I'm going to share my screen. Great. Can everybody see? Miyam no no tung Tristan yaka non payam goish man lusanyo. Hi, everybody. My name is Tristan Orozco. My pronouns are she, hers. I am Payam Gawish, or the colonizer calls us Luceño. Our territory is northern San Diego to Riverside County up until the edge of Orange County. I am a mom and partner, doula, placenta specialist, midwifery student, and birth rights and choice advocate. So let's get started. I wanted to start off with this quote. We come from water. It nourished us inside our mother's bodies as it nourishes us here on Mother Earth. Water is sacred. Water is our first home. Inside the amniotic sac is water. It's 99% of water. It nourishes our babies. It is a cushion and protector of our babies. It helps regulate the temperature of our babies. So water is extremely important in the development of a baby in the womb and overall health. Pregnancy, you need water. Staying hydrated is so important. It can help relieve and alleviate a lot of ailments that a lot of people deal with in pregnancy. And I want to say you cannot talk about the contamination of water and the issues around water and environmental racism without talking about land, air, and fire, like all of the elements, because you can't separate them. So my work started back in college when I first began to understand the global magnitude of the issues surrounding environmental racism and violence. So some of the things we're seeing in relation to reproductive justice and assault, essentially, are physical harms of environmental violence, especially in indigenous communities. So we're related to the reproductive system, we're seeing high rates. And I'm talking like anywhere from 2 times national average all the way up to 20 times the national average of miscarriages, various cancers, decrease in testosterone production and infertility. In fetal development, we're seeing congenital anomalies, fetal death, or stillbirth. There's high rates of lactation transmission, meaning the parent is being exposed to all these chemicals. They're eating fish from rivers, for example. And so when they choose to breastfeed their baby, those chemicals are ultimately going through their breast milk and into their baby. This is affecting the cognitive, thyroid, and endocrine functions of those babies. And then childhood development, we see high rates of reproductive cancers, asthma, early onset puberty, autoimmune diseases, and cognitive functions are being disrupted. Some other things we are seeing not necessarily related to reproduction is cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, autoimmune diseases, etc. And again, this is representing land, air, water, and fire, right? So we're seeing represented in these is nuclear mining, waste dumping, dumping in rivers, fracking, mining of all types of resources, chemical plants and manufacturing plants, and pollution that is specifically targeting Indigenous communities. So this is my short spiel. I look forward to the rest of the conversation that we're going to have. So I'll just stop sharing. And whoever's next.
Thank you so much, Tristan. Carla, do you want to go next?
Sure. Okay, ni stu ni taniku na du kyayaki ni amskapi pikani. Hello, my name is Carla Bird. I'm a member of the Blackfeet Nation. My Indian name is Two Bear Woman, which was given to me by my great late uncle, Leo Bolshu. I was named after my great great grandmother, Two Bear Woman. I am currently the president of Blackfeet Community College. And one of the missions that I really work towards is, which is also the mission of our institution, is tribal-centered education. And really understanding what does tribal-centered education mean and what does it look like in the classroom or the institution. This semester, we were very delighted to offer a free online Bikani language course to the community. We found some very, very interesting insights from the course. One of the mission of tribal-centered education is to incorporate those Indigenous modalities of learning and education. And so when you think about traditional education prior to colonialism, it was a mentorship and it was based on the natural world, survivorship, it was mentorship, it was hands-on training, it was experiential. And so that mentorship piece was significant. And so when we think about what does that look like in the classroom, it means incorporating elders into the institution for that mentorship. We also practice, we're a big believer and the research is behind this, but cultural resiliency. We know that our students need to achieve wellness, or not necessarily achieve, but to practice wellness. And based off of our medicine wheel, that we know that if they're practicing holistic wellness, that they're going to be successful, not only in the classroom, but outside the classroom. And so with this online course, due to COVID-19, we understood that here on the Blackfeet Reservation that COVID-19 was very, very, very detrimental to our community and also was a huge risk factor for our culture and language. And so we opted to do a free online Bikani language course. We've had 300 people present at least every Zoom session, which is twice a week. And they have direct access to an elder. And we're looking at the traditional model of education through Zoom, surprisingly. But what that process is like for those participants, those community members. We do offer an online language class here at BCC where students can take it for course credit, and they're working towards achieving course credit and a grade. But the community education piece is really about the investment of the community, that they're there because they want to be there and they have an invested commitment to our language. And so I was thinking about kind of the difference between Western and Indigenous education, where oftentimes in Westernized education, we really teach children in the school system of how to achieve awards based on behavior, and based on behavior, there's potentially a punishment or a consequence. And so when you think about the Indigenous worldview, philosophy of child rearing and education, there's no punishment or reward system, but there's there's more or less a mentorship in place and some self-management skills where mastery is a big part of that self-esteem. So we encourage our youth and our children to master things. We set the role model. The adults are the role model. And so it's a community-based learning. And I think about how that translates to our online language class, that students are there because not because there's a grade to be earned, not because there's credit to be earned, but there's a need to master something. And so what, interestingly, I was thinking, you know, they're intrinsically motivated, but more importantly, and I think this might be a new word, I'm not sure, our new concept that perhaps I just made up, but also inherently motivated, their lineage, whatever that may be, they're inherently motivated to learn their language at a very, very critical time. So that's some of the work that we do here at Blackfeet Community College in Montana.
Thank you so much. Sadie, do you wanna go next?
Yes, I'd be happy to. Ait squail siam anishelicha quasomut senesnat cha uklamisin sahanap e kusamat sunny e alling Karen e Virgil senesosila Sally e Herman Olson senesosila soitsin ohiluk quinis asla atiakias nukchisin mqualia quinis inatachel nestleet quinis qual aquaquino squall out san kachit sa uklamichasin E utatasin quenis twinelps. Skeno ait strite. Hello, my good friends and respected people. My name is Quasselmut Sadie Olson. I am from the Lummi Nation. Troy Olson and Shirley Williams are my parents. Sahanup Senaman. Troy Olson is my father. And Kusamut Senatan. Shirley Williams is my mother. Karen Williams and Virgil Williams are my grandparents, and Sally Jack and Herman Olson are my grandparents. I'm happy to see all of you here today. I just wanted to say a few words. I don't know the Lummi language and I am still learning how to speak it. Very good work, everybody. I am honored to be here and to be a part of the National Campus Compact Conference. I thank you, Western Washington University, Campus Compact, for taking the time and consideration to talk about the important reason that we're here for resilience and responsibility for racial and environmental justice. I am a student at Northwest Indian College and I am majoring in Native Environmental Science. I am also a co-founder of a Native-led nonprofit organization called White Swan Environmental. And our mission is to support community healing through the natural, cultural, and historical restoration to the Salish Sea for seventh generation sustainability. We are the vision keepers for a 13 moon, Indigenous-led, mountain to sea, reef to reef, K through PhD programming with seven longhouses in the San Juan Islands and seven longhouses in the Gulf Islands. We believe this will forever allow Coast Salish peoples to practice our treaty rights and inherent birthrights. This will offer a measure of cultural, historical, and ecological health protection and sustainability that can be modeled all across the United States and Canada. Soitsin ohiluk quenis inatachel. I am so happy to see all of you here today. Please visit our website at whiteswanenvironmental.org. And if you would like to look at the website with me very quickly, I would be happy to just do a quick scroll through because there are some momentums over the past few years about what we have been doing. And I would just briefly like to go over that. Okay. This is the college that I go to. I'm a student at Northwest Indian College, and we are a Native-led or a Native school. This is our website for our Native-led nonprofit organization that has been co-founded by Sahanup, Kusamut, and Quasselmut. These are our 7 project areas: Indigenous Public Health, the Spirit of the Shkwala, SOS Stewardship Corps. We're working on a digital eco-cultural mapping project, Field to Classroom Programs and Curriculum, which is co-partnered with Whatcom Intergenerational High School. Shirley Williams and Cindy Ruther are co-founders of the Whatcom Intergenerational High School, and the pillars of this program are the First Peoples Principles of Learning, intergenerational learning, cultural literacy, and place-based learning. We're working on 13 Moon food sovereignty. So this is really based from our Indigenous elders who have been a part of our elder advisory council. So we have been strongly led by our elders and have listened to their stories of how they gathered food and how we can continue to try to rediscover and decolonize our ways of gathering food and creating a more circular system to be rooted in health. We're also working on legislative advocacy. So we go to our local government and we help to advocate for houses of healing and houses of learning, longhouse restoration. And this is where we would hope to have the Coast Salish Tribal Heritage Field Institute. March has been a very exciting month. We had, this exciting panel about resilience and responsibility for racial and environmental justice, which are very important topics because social justice and environmental justice go hand in hand. And we were also a part of the Invisible Hands screening and the Youth International Conference about the movie called Invisible Hands, which is a bipartisan movement to give rights to nature. And in the system that we're working in now, it's very corporate led, and this is a way to give the rights back to nature so that the community can advocate for nature. And that is a great movie. I highly recommend it. I was partnered with We Are Native to be a part of that program. And I just want to go through our elder advisory board. So Sayatha Mary Wagner was born in a longhouse in Saanich Nation, BC. She traveled and lived in the San Juan Islands when she was a little girl with her dad. She travels with our youth and community and generously shares her wisdom. We are forever grateful to Sayatha. She was here at our story pole raising ceremony. That's where this picture comes from. Salik William James is the hereditary chief of the Lummi Nation. He is our respected CM, our respected elder. He guides the work of White Swan Environmental, WE. If it wasn't for Salik's teachings and guidance, none of this work would have manifested. We are eternally grateful to Salik. We respectfully took his photo off of our website for the year because that is our practices in our community. He passed away June 1st of 2020. And we keep all photos out of public eye for a year. Jacinth Stokwals, he was raised in Kwisanich. He received 2 honorary PhDs for carrying his father's legacy work forward to preserve the Tsimshian language. His father, David Elliott, wanted his children to remember who they are and where they come from, and to remember their inherent birthrights to the land, water, salmon, reef net, and language that belongs to it. Stokwals is the name of Friday Harbor in San Juan Island, and his grandma testified his father was born in Mitchell Bay on San Juan Island. Jacinth Stokwals, John Elliott, is a respected elder of the Kwisanich Nation and has taught Tlewanuk tribal school in Saanich for over 30 years. He co-founded First Voices and teaches evenings at Camosun College. This is our reef net captain. The first model of the reef net captain Jacinksit made for his mother. And he was very gracious to share this artwork of this salmon woman, or the reef net woman, carrying her reef net with her. And she helps to remind us of the male and female balance that is very important to remember. And I'm going to go back to the homepage to share how our youth are involved in the Coast Salish, or this Spirit of the Shkwala Youth Stewardship Corps, to honor our reef net, which we have revitalized. And it was a way of doing treaty protection, as the reef net model was used to prevent the Hwichiacum Cherry Point terminal of coal refining. My father was named on Henry Island. So this has been a very deep practice of returning to our ceremonies. And I think as we're learning to decolonize and we have to survive as Indigenous peoples, we will return to our ancestral ways of ceremony and honor and respect. And that's a value that is carried within various voyaging communities. If you scroll down further, there's the mission and vision, which I stated in the introduction. Haishka, for your time. This is our partnership with the National Park Service. Alexis Freedy, and this is the women salmon story pole, and this is the male salmon story pole, and our reef net woman, which we put on Papiawas, which is where English camp once was, where we used to have a 600 to 800 foot longhouse, which is no longer there. And there is now in a camp where that signifies the pig war. So we've kind of been doing some historical restoration in partnership with our own familial and spiritual healing, of reconnecting to a lost technology and family connections due to imperialism and colonialism and environmental and racial prejudice.
Thank you so much, Sadie, for that presentation and your amazing work. Robin, do you want to present, and then we will jump into conversation?
Sure. Thank you. Gosh, it's such an honor to be here. I really appreciate, the organizers, the sponsors of this event, and the inspirational and wise comments of Dr. Osorio at the beginning, as well as the inspirational poet artists that really brought an important reminder of the fierce urgency of now with climate change. And likewise, an honor to be with my panelists here today. I'm from talking to you from Missoula, Montana, and these are the Aboriginal territories of the Salish and Kalispell people. At the University of Montana, we honor the path they have always shown us in caring for this place and for generations to come. I go by the pronouns he, him, his, and I am a person of color, and I'm also biracial. I'm the son of an immigrant from South Asia, and I also have Eastern European heritage. And even though I'm a settler, I have colonial trauma through my father's side. It's in my DNA, and I've only scarcely begun to understand what that's about. I have a strong commitment to social justice too, and that's part of my DNA and my family's heritage as well, that makes me proud to be doing the work that I've been doing for so long I've been involved in an environmental justice movement for about 30 years as a student and a researcher and an educator and an activist. And much of my work is kind of wonky. You know, it's pretty data-driven. I've done, a lot of my work is devoted to quantitative studies and developing methods for assessing racial and socioeconomic disparities in the location of environmental hazards. I've got a couple quick slides I'll put up if possible here. Let's see how this goes. So this is showing here the report Toxic Waste and Race at 20. And this was a replication of the landmark study in 1987, the report called Toxic Waste and Race in the United States. That was the first national study that showed there was a pattern of Superfund sites and hazardous waste facilities being located in people of color communities. And it really helped bring national attention. It helped give a lot of fuel to the environmental justice movement. And so we replicated that study after 20 more years and found that the situation had not actually improved, that the problems of racial disparities still continued. And so what we find though is that when you look at a whole range of different polluting industrial facilities, many of the same types of ones that Professor Romero talked about, we find similar patterns. In this study with the Center for Health and Effective Government, we found children to be particularly at risk from living near facilities that handle dangerous chemicals that are subject to release and explosions and chemical fires, and highlighting just another vulnerable population that we need to think about. And I'm just thinking about, Tristan, about your comments too about the unborn and children being particularly affected. So that's been one big part of my work. I've been involved in helping a number of other organizations look at other types of risks, such as our drinking water supply nationally, as well as thinking about how polluting facilities intersect with natural hazards like hurricanes. And you know, we've seen in Houston and other cities tremendous damage from flooding due to the extreme rain events. Then I've also worked on the first federal court case that found that an environmental justice analysis is part of the NEPA process. So the environmental impact statement was flawed. This is the first time the federal courts have found a flawed analysis. So we several of us criticized the Army Corps of Engineers analysis and were able to hopefully get some improvement in how those racial justice analyses are done in the future by the federal government. And then a big part of my work though, and this is the part I'll probably want to talk about the most today or discuss at least with the panel is using community-based participatory research in Indigenous communities. And this was the one project that I carried out with a number of students and partners on the Blackfeet Reservation about 10 years ago. And a lot of good insights come from that. And let me just say too, I'll stop sharing here, that a few different insights that I wanna bring up that come from this work. You know, first of all, I see CBPR, that's community-based participatory research, being really a decolonizing methodology. It's an approach of sharing power, of community-led involvement in the research process and deep partnership building. And as a non-Indigenous person, it's important for me to just acknowledge my role as a non-Indigenous person who works to support Indigenous rights and tribal environmental justice. I've done that in a number of ways, and it's always leading from behind. It's, or following. And for example, in advocating for the transfer of the National Bison Range to the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes, which is one of the rare repatriations of taken lands that we've seen in the last, 500 years. And so we should celebrate that. And then I've also worked with the Chippewa Cree tribe on a climate vulnerability assessment. And so bringing in, you know, some of the expertise of the university to assist tribes with their work in preparing for, not even preparing, but for dealing with the existing effects. This all kind of brings up sort of a core tenet of the environmental justice movement that is really informative to my work. The idea that the late Dana Alston put forward, the idea we speak for ourselves, and the we is not me, the we is you, Indigenous people. And the idea of we speak for ourselves rejects the idea of being represented by others. It rejects the idea of being spoken for or spoken down to or spoken about. Instead, it calls for self-representation, of having a seat at the table. It fits with the idea of procedural justice, the right to be heard on decisions that affect one's lives. And as a privileged person, in many ways, I see my place as helping the voices of my BIPOC brothers and sisters to get heard, to be centered and raised, as we talked about. And a lot of cases that involves marshaling data or knowledge from the community. And Professor Romero raises a lot of important questions and interesting points about who gets to decide what knowledge is considered valid and is used, and who gets to use it. And so I would argue that that can only be done through collaboration, through building relationships and trust, and that takes a long time. So the second point is that environmental justice as it relates to Indigenous peoples is fundamentally about tribal sovereignty. It's not about just having a voice, it's about actually those of us who aren't Indigenous peoples respecting and supporting it, even if we don't agree with it, that the right to self-determination needs to be manifest. And that that means including recognizing institutions of or structures of systemic discrimination, and taking a critical analysis of how structural discrimination works, and unpacking it and dismantling it. And I personally haven't written a lot about it, but I find the concept of structure of settler colonialism really informative and helpful in navigating our way collectively through a more just and fair society. So those are, one last thing, I'm sorry, I know we need to get moving. Just that for me to, you know, it's really, there's ethical principles involved in doing this work that have to ground me, and that are so important, and that we can maybe talk about as well, that need to be the groundwork for good, effective and respectful partnerships between Indigenous and non-Indigenous communities that I would say are pretty much essential for getting this work done. We have to work together. We have to be allies and understand and respect what each other can bring to the table. So I look forward to discussing these aspects of advancing environmental justice and Indigenous rights and some of the principles for EJ environmental justice practice with all of you.
Thank you, Robin. And thank you all of you for the incredible, absolutely incredible work that you all do. I just want to note time, because I want to really prioritize our conversation. So we're going to take a little 10 minutes extra for us to be in conversation with each other, and then shave a little off the Q&A, just because I really want to prioritize the fact that you all are in the same space, and then take a little some time for some questions from the audience. So I'll start the conversation with something that we've all talked about when we've touched base with each other, which is the redefining of the term resiliency as something for BIPOC communities to define for themselves, not for white institutions to demand or to define for them. My first question, how do you define the terms of resiliency? Is there a better word? Perhaps it's resistance or a radical posture or proposition, abolition, mutual aid, or a lens that looks to the future. So I'm just curious, like how you all define resiliency in the context of your own work.
I know for myself, I prefer revitalization. And that's the reclamation of identity and cultural practices. That's re-indigenizing parenting and how we view the land, how birth goes and different medicines that we use by incorporating Western medicine when it's needed and traditional methods of healing when it's needed. There has to be a balance, but ultimately I prefer revitalization and re-indigenizing. It seems more active in terms of using resiliency. That doesn't, for me, it doesn't necessarily seem like it's an active word. Whereas revitalization, I can put exactly what I mean to that word.
One of the areas that I spent a lot of time researching was the area of resiliency. And we know from the research that, gosh, it's probably been studied academically for 40 to 50 years. But we know within the Blackfoot worldview that the concept of resiliency is ancient. And so the concept, whether it was a different term, really is an ancient concept of the Blackfoot people. I think early research really examined whether resiliency was individual characteristics, and then it started to evolve to resiliency can be external characteristics. So rather than Carla being resilient and her colleagues not resilient, we start examining external factors of resiliency, which could be community, it could be ceremony, it could be family. And then the more that research kind of evolved, we started to hear the indigenous voice resonate within research of resiliency. And we started to find the traditional concepts of resiliency resonate through our indigenous researchers, our indigenous authors. And what we found was that when we think about resiliency in a Blackfoot worldview, we realize that, we understand this whole Blackfoot worldview of balance and what does that mean? We kind of are encapsulated sometimes by this Westernized ideology that we're hit by television shows and we're hit by media that we have to always be happy at every single moment. And if we purchase this thing, it's going to make us happy. And it's like this obsession with being happy when you look at the Blackfoot worldview, and this is off of the work of Dr. Iris Heavyrunner Pretty Paint, that balance is not only accepting those emotions of happiness, but to be in balance is to accept those emotions of sadness, and that we walk in balance, accepting both the happy and sad moments and events in our lives, that we're not just going to be encapsulated by this achievement of happiness. And so when we think about that walk of balance of accepting not only the negative or those unfortunate events, but also those happy and enlightening events, we realize that wellness is holistic. And so it wasn't until Indigenous researchers started to put their writing forth and examined what resiliency is in the Blackfoot worldview. And I imagine for many Indigenous nations that resiliency incorporates this piece of spirituality. And so we know that the medicine wheel, in order for us as Blackfoot people to be well, we must take care of ourselves spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and physically. In Westernized society, we often take care of ourselves physically, sometimes emotionally, sometimes mentally, but it's almost like this spirituality concept's kind of put on the outside as you know, some maybe what some people pursue, but it's such a vital component to us as Indigenous people. And so when you start examining resiliency, you start realizing that it's based on this spirituality concept for Indigenous people, and recognizing that and validating that and incorporating that into your whole worldview, that as your foundation. And so when I think of resiliency, it really is this basis and foundation of spirituality, which when you know, what is spirituality? Well, it's the belief in the interconnectedness and the interrelatedness of all things in this world.
That's great. I guess I would add that, or just when I think about it, I guess I hadn't really thought about it as much until you brought this question to us, Carmen, because, you know, there are real vulnerabilities that tribal communities have. And when I think about what I've learned about climate change, that that there are serious changes going on in communities with plants and animals that are important for traditional practices, for you know, for people's life ways, if you will. And you know, with animals and plants, you know, well, we hear about, well, they can adapt, they can move farther north, but if that's outside of your traditional lands or your reservation, or, you know, your mountains only go so high, and those animals have nowhere to go. I mean, it's sort of, we need to realize that this idea can kind of trap us into thinking we can always adapt when we can't. And so there needs to be, we shouldn't take too much comfort, I guess, in necessarily in being resilient when there's thresholds that our communities can't really deal with. So there's sort of some issues with it too, with like when I think about it, and I think this was maybe your idea, Carmen, but this idea that, well, you know, say you have a, you know, COVID, or say there's a bad storm, like, oh, just go back to the way you were. Well, what's the reset point? Is it 1950? Is it 1970? Is it 700, 1700? I mean, we can't be in the situation where we think normal is something that's a situation of oppression, of settler colonialism. And so, you know, so that's why I kind of like what you said about revitalization, and I would say resistance too. Resistance to the idea that, you know, stay in your place, stay in your lane. Those messages about, you know, you can't ask for more. All those things that I think people of color hear all the time, that's not there. We need to be resistant to that, not resilient to it.
Absolutely. Thank you. And Sadie, do you also want to add to the conversation?
Yeah, I'll add, I believe that resiliency, we've been having this conversation a lot in our community, especially with the coronavirus and the fact that we're in a global pandemic right now, and we had to act quickly as a nation to make sure that our community was in place, sheltering in place, so that we were not being impacted by the health concerns that were directly, I mean, prominent in our communities. So we really had to discuss how we wanted to ensure that our relationships were being protected with one another, and we wanted to make sure that our community members were not going to be in harm, and we wanted to ensure that everybody knows the protocol and practices for being a healthy community. And so there is I think that there's a functioning health team here in the Lummi Nation. for at least working together and presenting resources to the community. And so I think I just wanted to uplift and promote the Lemmy Nation and their values of protecting and promoting and preserving who we are and where we come from in our culture, as that is, I mean, we, our logo is the eagle, and it seems like we really care about each other. We do our best to remind each other to be resilient, to pray, and to just take care of each other. And then going into my education and taking my own identity as a student and as an intern for the community engagement fellows, which I had been for the past few quarters, I went to Whatcom Community College, which is in Bellingham, and I was able to be a part of a whole bunch of different cohorts. And the point of the Center of Community Learning is to connect the community in Bellingham to the higher education institutions, because, you know, here it's very easy to see that the higher education institution is actually on a hill and you have to drive up the hill to go there. And then there's people in the community who are doing their work, and there was not really like a dotted line connecting the community and the institutions. And as I was an intern, I was able to work in the community, and we had, you know, there was librarians, there was teachers, there was students, there was also professors from the educational, higher educational institutions. There were administrators for the institution. There were marine biologists and, you know, non-government organizations who were all there. Just a whole bunch of different people that you would have never anticipated being in the same sort of circles to communicate and to discuss that we had issues in our own disciplinaries, because our higher education institutions are very, they say like pedagogical, or they have pedagogies where everybody's like separated into our own disciplinaries. And so, you know, there's not much like connection with language that the higher education institutions use. And, you know, we have our own issues as community organizers or community members. And these are the types of words that we use for them. This is the vocabulary that we use saying, this is our problem. And then you come to a solution, or a solution-oriented dialogue space, where we're able to share our problems with one another. And all of those boundaries that we once had, they just kind of disappear. We're like, oh wow, you face that problem with scheduling? So do I. Like, you face that problem with your community members like leaving sometimes, and then you having an empty space and you needing to fill it? So do I. Like, these are all things that we are facing in our community, because we have relationships with one another. So when I think about resiliency, and I think about us being able to bounce back from a problem, which is something that Indigenous people have had to do since the doctrine of discovery, when people were moving historically from the East Coast to the West Coast, or even from, you know, in, from the West Coast and colonizing from various places, I would say like in the California region or the southern region, and then moving upwards, specifically where I live. We've had quite a bit of time to preserve and protect our culture, but we are still facing the impacts of colonization on our health and on our community members. You know, we don't know the history of Native peoples. So like, where is the relationship with Native peoples and the community? And that's kind of like where my role was oddly enough, to like share something that I know about the relationships that my community has had with education and legislation, and how that has been a negative thing, and trying to transmute that negativity into a positive thing. So that's where another point of resiliency is. You really have to be in that growth mindset, in that state of like, I'm trying to turn something negative that has been seen as negative or has been negative in my community and present it in a way that's positive and uplifting so that we can make a difference for our future generations and take those values or not conform the values of our ancestors and take them exactly as they are and transmute them into a new culture so that we can all have the same culture and that impact can grow and grow. So that's why we consider seventh generation sustainability, because a long time ago when my ancestors were signing the treaty, they were thinking of me and they were thinking of, you know, who I am and where I come from and how much we want to protect and preserve that. And that's why I think about the next seven generations that are going to come after me. And I also think about those ones that came before me. So it's always like living in a space of past, present, and future. And that's a very big theme in relationship building or relationships in general, is that you always have to think about the past, present, and future. And I definitely agree about holistic healing. As Carla mentioned, I think that holistic healing is very important. And as a tribal youth delegate from the Northwest Portland Area Indian Health Board, we helped create a youth policy with the California Rural Indian Health Board to assess holistic healing. And that takes place-based learning, that takes intergenerational learning, that takes a health focus, and it also takes community partnerships. You have to have those relationships. So considering your own self in that and how you can think in that spiritual, mental, physical, and emotional healthy self, it's always influencing your community, and you have the tools and resources to reach out to your community. And as Dr. Romero mentioned I'm thinking of the first panelist. To say aloha and give them deep regards and to give them deep respect and have the reciprocal relationship to, you know, look somebody in the eyes and say hello and wait for them to say hello back. Dr. John Osorio. Haishka for your words, and thank you all for letting me be on this panel and sharing my thoughts with you about resiliency.
Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts. I do have to, we may have to do a little recalibrating to our programming if we're going to respond to one more question. So let's see where we are. Oh goodness, we are about 15 minutes over time. So I think in order to make a little bit of time for some Q&A from the audience, what do you all think we should do? Should we ask one more question, or should we make time for Q&A? What's your preference as panelists?
Well, I would vote for hearing from the audience.
For the audience? Okay. All right, then. We'll do that. I really wish we had more time, and I'm not entirely sure how and Sadie, Tristan, Carla, do you have, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, that sounds like a great idea. Some questions from the audience.
Great.
So, I'm open to anything.
Thank you for your flexibility. I truly wish we had more time. Just to revisit the run of show, we will take a quick pause to collect questions from the audience to post to our amazing panel. And we will hear a few words from our sponsor, and we'll have another poem and performance from Kathy Gentle Kilner. So please do stick around, audience members, for Kathy's performance and for a Q&A with our panelists, which will be about 15 minutes in length. And then we will have our closing statements from Atina. So we will be back in about 10 minutes.
Our next speaker was selected from more than 500 candidates to represent the voice of civil society. From the Marshall Islands, please welcome Kathy Jetnil Kijimo.
Yahweh Gomolib, I would like to share with you a poem that I have written for my daughter, Matefele Benam. Dear Matefele Benam, you are a seven-month-old sunrise of gummy smiles. You are bald as an egg and bald as the Buddha. Your thighs that are thunder, shrieks that are lightning, so excited for bananas, hugs, and our morning walks along the lagoon. Dear Matefele Benam, I want to tell you about that lagoon, that lucid, sleepy lagoon lounging against the sunrise. Men say that one day, that lagoon will devour you. They say it will gnaw at the shoreline, chew at the roots of your breadfruit trees, gulp down rows of your seawalls, and crunch through your island's shattered bones. They say you, your daughter, and your granddaughter too, will wander rootless, with only a passport to call home. Dear Matefele Benam, don't cry. Mommy promises you, no one will come and devour you. No greedy whale of a company sharking through political seas. No backwater bullying of businesses with broken morals. No blindfolded bureaucracies gonna push this mother ocean over the edge. No one's drowning, baby. No one's moving. No one's losing their homeland. No one's gonna become a climate change refugee. Or should I say, no one else. To the Carteret Islanders of Papua New Guinea and to the Taro Islanders of Fiji, I take this moment to apologize to you. We are drawing the line here. Because baby, we are going to fight. Your mommy, daddy, boo-boo, jima, your country, and your president too, we will all fight. And even though there are those hidden behind platinum titles who like to pretend that we don't exist, that the Marshall Islands, Tuvalu, Kiribati, Maldives, and Typhoon Haiyan in the Philippines, and floods of Pakistan, Algeria, and Colombia, and hurricanes, tidal waves, and earthquakes didn't exist. Still, there are those who see us. Hands reaching out, fists raising up, banners unfurling, megaphones booming, and we are canoes blocking coal ships. We are the radiance of solar villages. We are the rich, clean soil of the farmer's past. We are petitions blooming from teenage fingertips. We are families biking, recycling, reusing, engineers dreaming, designing, building, artists painting, dancing, writing. We are spreading the word. And there are thousands out on the street, marching with signs, hand in hand, chanting for change now. They're marching for you, baby. They're marching for us. Because we deserve to do more than just survive. We deserve to thrive. Dear Matefele Benam, you are eyes heavy with drowsy weight. So just close those eyes, baby, and sleep in peace. Because we won't let you down. You'll see.
Hello, my name is George Liu, co-founder of Give Pulse. I want to thank this community for allowing us to support the work you all do. At this time, I want to invite my colleague, Dr. John Sallmarsh, to share with you more about Project HERE, Higher Education for Reparations Engagement. John?
Thanks, George. I'm John Sallmarsh, and Project HERE has been created by a group of scholars and activists from local communities and campuses, creating a resource hub that assembles curricular and co-curricular resources, programs, and syllabi to dig deeper into our country's history of racism and discrimination, and to acknowledge the role and responsibility of higher education institutions to enact racial justice and healing. The resource hub located at GivePulse and publicly available is aimed at facilitating a change in political conditions to advance reparations locally, on campuses, and nationally.
Thank you, John. We welcome this community to join us in this long and unending journey towards a more perfect union. And to live up to our founding principle that all people are created equal. Thank you all. Be well, healthy, safe, and have a great rest of conference.
At Portland State University, students and educators live and work at the democratic crossroads of oppression and equity, violence and peace, injustice and justice. PSU motto, Let Knowledge Serve, provides a curricular and co-curricular pathway for equity-centered community-engaged learning through racial, educational, and environmental justice, critical solidarity with diverse communities, scholarly advocacy for advancing equity. PSU partners with organizations like Coffee Creek Prison to empower incarcerated women through educational and career readiness opportunities, with City Repair to design and build sustainable shelters for the homeless. Scholars like Dr. Dillifruz Williams have multiple publications on learning gardens and sustainability education. Senior capstone courses like those taught by Oregon Campus Compact Executive Director Carmen Dennison critically examine Black civil rights, connecting history with contemporary actions for racial justice. Building upon these foundations, the fully online Graduate Certificate in Service Learning offers engagement tools for leveraging social justice. Just 18 credits, the program can be completed in 3 to 4 academic quarters. Classmates are other community engagement professionals from across North America. Social justice practice combines high impact practices with critical race theory and critically engaged pedagogy. Students collaborate with their own local communities to design service activities and community service projects. Contact the program director, Professor Christine Kress, for additional information. Join colleagues to further empower yourself to help advance environmental resiliency and racial justice in your own community.
All right, welcome back, everyone. We're going to, everyone can turn their cameras back on. Great, so welcome back. So we're gonna have about roughly, let's see how much time we have. So we have, about 15 minutes for Q&A. So I will just jump right in and start with the first question. It's from a 7th grade science teacher who is teaching guided by the 17 UN sustainability goals. I focus on water, extinctions, and climate science. Inequities for people of color is part of what this individual teaches. They are also white. Because of that, what advice would you have for me to be taken seriously? Is that even possible? So can a white educator or a white teacher, what is the role, I think, of white people in teaching racial justice and social accountability?
Well, I can jump in with a few things that few thoughts come to mind. In Montana, we have a constitution. Where are you, Julianne? I'm not sure what state you're in, but in Montana, we have a constitutional provision that's called Indian Education for All. And it's a requirement that students in K through 12 and I believe college to learn about the distinct history of the tribes and communities in Montana. And the Office of Public Instruction here has worked with tribal communities to prepare those materials. So they're not coming, they're coming from culture committees and the communities themselves. And so it is a dicey area. But I think it's really, you know, whose stories are you telling? Are they white people's stories about tribes and tribal communities, or are they Indians, you know, American Indians speaking for themselves? It kind of goes back to that idea I brought up of we speak for ourselves, and who's getting to decide what history is told. So my personal perspective is that there needs to be greater recognition and understanding of our neighbors and our the original inhabitants of this land who have not gone away. And there are certain principles to use in doing that work, you know, of understanding that each tribe is very different and has a unique history. So that's just a couple thoughts that come to mind as, you know, your sources and finding those good ones.
When I was in college, I spent a lot of my time and efforts on decolonizing work or understanding what decolonizing was. And it's such a burden to place on a student or any individual because you have hundreds of years of research and authors that have that you could spend your lifetime trying to decolonize work. And it's such a burden and it's overwhelming. And it wasn't until that I learned more about tribal-centered education. Tribal-centered education, which is rather than decolonizing previous work, because even if you decolonize a piece of research, it might not fit the worldview of that specific tribe. And so when you transcend to tribal-centered methodologies, you're building it from the tribal worldview first. And it's such energizing work. It's so, you know, it's so energizing and it's such great work and you're building it from the root up. I would say when you look at, it's so important to have allies in this work and particularly allies that are teachers in the educational system. Robin suggested that we have standards here in Montana that all of our public education has to meet in order to teach the knowledge-based systems of the tribes that reside not only in Montana, but nationwide. But it's so imperative to gather that authentic knowledge, that those authentic sources. We know that you know, there's a lot of work written about the Blackfoot people, but it's from the perspective of the majority. And when you actually go to the authentic sources, they'll tell you the same story, but from a different perspective. And so, for example, you know, a lot of what's written about the Blackfeet is that we were these raiders and, you know, these horsemen and, you know, but when you look at the Blackfoot worldview, compassion, the notion of compassion and love and caring is so imperative to how we exist. And it's the highest concept we have, but yet we're written about as kind of these raiders of the plains. And so looking at your sources and incorporating, it's such an isolating experience to be a minority student when you're in the classroom and you know, you don't see yourself reflected in the literature or the curriculum or in the student body or in research or even in faculty or teachers. It can be really isolating experience. And so I would always recommend that go to the authentic sources, read work from the people who represent those populations, read the research, also try to incorporate tribal-centered methodologies because it's so imperative that we have that taught in the school system. I also recommend, you know, Dr. Tatum's work, T-A-T-E-M. She talks a lot about how to incorporate that in a school system, particularly, you know, the important work that we need our allies to do with us.
I just want to add, because I see Julianne is based in San Diego. You could reach out to the Kumeyaay Nation or like any of the Luseno tribes, because that is their traditional territory. A lot of them have cultural departments and their own schools. So reaching out to them, I think, would be one of the best resources because it's from the actual people. And I also know that California has new legislation that is in the works of rewriting the indigenous curriculum that's taught in public schools. I think it's still at like the baby phase of rewriting it, but I do know that tribes are involved in how that will be presented to grades K through 12. So that's something to look out for too as well.
Hi, I wanted to touch on what Carla said again about how we take the pathway of compassion and being loving and patient, and also just realizing how connected we are and how interconnected we are, whether that be socially or environmentally. You know, we all share water, and if you really want to get involved with an indigenous community, I would say to find out where your local river is. And that's something that I've been doing in my geology class and studying, well, specifically here, we're salmon people, or we're saltwater salmon people. And we care about the saltwater salmon. And we really want our saltwater salmon to be in our rivers and to have access from, you know, their homelands where they're spawning, and then to where they need to be so that we can have a relationship with our salmon. And that is our food sovereignty. That is what we have had as a staple in our diet for so long, is salmon. And so, you know, there's a connection between our ecology and our geology. So, you know, why has that been a staple in our diet? There's so many health benefits to having specific foods from your environment in your food system that you're eating. You're adapting to the environment in that way, and you're able to make those healthy changes for yourself and your community while also strengthening the environment that you're in. So again, think about the rivers that you're nearby, and then the infrastructure that's locally around the environment, and creating policy, as Dr. Romero said, with our local governments and our state and national government, to ensure protection. And a new bipartisan movement, or not exactly new, a bipartisan movement is the Rights of Nature. And that movement has helped the New Zealand communities give their river rights of nature. So they've been able to return to some of their indigenous knowledge systems because they have given their river rights. Water is life. Water is life.
Thank you so much for your responses. So let's see. So one more question. I'm curious about what the panelists think about how resilience can be used to weaponize and harm people of color. For example, society believing that BIPOC folks are resilient, so it justifies that it is okay to continue to inflict harm.
Well, I agree. And I kind of made the comment earlier too, that, you know, that resilience is, you're right. It can be used as, well, you're going to be okay. You've survived this long, but what is the, you know, what are we willing to accept then? Or what are communities willing to accept? Are they willing, is that a sort of a way of saying, just accept the status quo? Because my point is there needs to be there needs to be a reckoning for systemic discrimination in this country, our history of systemic discrimination in this country. There really needs to be some sort of better recognition of the historical injustices. We need to start unpacking those in so many different ways, and you know, starting a process of reconciliation, and it's just taking the resilience just takes the focus off of, I think, what's really important. And you know, it's really interesting seeing that interlude about reparations, because I was going to bring that up. We're starting to see reparations for African American farmers. When is that going to be coming to Indigenous communities? What does that even look like? What about the stolen land? What about repatriation? There's so much work to do that it's just, let's keep the focus on those things is how I would respond to that, I guess.
I would say that, you know, in my experience, it almost seems that ignorance is equally as harmful as people knowingly that a certain population is considered resilient. In my experience, it's also been, although unintentional in some ways, or I guess you could argue otherwise, but that ignorance has been harmful in not recognizing, not validating the history of the historical injustices and understanding how resilient people have had to be in order to survive, in order for us to be here. It has been equally harmful, whether the intent is there or not, just in my experience, not understanding, not knowing. For example, you know, COVID-19 has been detrimental across the United States, particularly very detrimental to communities of color. American Indians have severe underlying health disparities due to colonization, due to traditional food systems being destroyed. You know, we have so much health disparities that COVID-19 was so detrimental to our community. We had so many losses, and with each elder, there's loss to culture and language and community. And for our counterparts to not understand that and to feel that, you know, to not understand those inequities that are the foundation of what we've experienced through COVID-19 has been so detrimental. And so in my experience, you know, just not understanding the history, let alone even the concept of resilience, is so detrimental and so, you know, harmful and hurtful in so many ways. And so my experience has been people just not understanding that piece.
Just because we're resilient doesn't mean we are immune to trauma. That's kind of the first thing that I think of. When you look at policy and federal policy, Native communities are considered a national sacrifice for the betterment of the rest of society in the United States. Though we have a government relationship with the United States government, it's the treaties are not upheld. Nothing is upheld by the United States government. You can't rely on them to do anything, really. And we see that again, we're a national sacrifice, and it's written in court opinions. And I don't think people understand that part of the issues of exploiting Indigenous communities and resources. So I just want to kind of add that, because I think that's kind of a missing piece, is that yes, we are sovereign nations, but we're not seen as sovereign nations. We're seen as national sacrifices for the betterment of this country.
I would like to say, when I think about how institutions have hurt or harmed Indigenous communities, I really go back to the stories that I've heard from my elders who share, you know, about their experiences in boarding schools. And we used to have a very holistic way of learning where, you know, wisdom was passed from generation to generation. You know, the grandparents were with the children telling stories. The children would grow up into adults. They'd pass those stories on to the next generation. And so that knowledge was very significantly transmitted. And then once boarding schools came around with different policies that were created by the federal government, like the Dawes Act and the Re-Education and Reorganization Act and the Allotment Act, there are different eras of federal Indian policy that I've learned about through Northwest Indian College, and each has had its own traumatizing effect on Native communities. And so that's kind of our relationship with education, is that the school is here to destroy who we are and disconnect us from where we come from. There was a quote by the Carlisle Indian boarding school that was, you know, that's one of the only quotes that you hear while I was in high school, which was, destroy the Indian, save the man. And that is the, you know, it was the national thought process for a lot of people that was, I want to say, like, it was going from like top to bottom, where the government was saying that, and it was inflicting this harm on people, and they didn't even really know about it until the Merriam Report, which the Merriam Report was the first study on reservations of how education and legislation about health, I mean, our healthcare that we receive and our education resources that we receive was impacting Indigenous communities. And it showed that a lot of Indigenous communities were in poverty and states of like just torment. And we're really trying to overcome that. That's where we're coming from. So, you know, we're born into this place where like we carry all of these traumas and these stories, and then we have to go into our schools where they're, I mean, I personally went to a mostly white school. It was kind of diverse, and there was certain clubs for like the diverse groups of kids, like the Mecha Club, which was for the like Latinx kids, and Oxala Club, which is for Indigenous kids. And then there was like the student leadership club, where you'd see like one or two people that were colored in those organizations. So, and I live in a farm town, you know, like when I would go to school, I would see a farm town. And then every time that our reservation has floods, it just goes over like one of the only roads that gets us into our reservations. And there are other reservations in our region that I've met while I've been a tribal youth delegate for the Northwest Portland Area Indian Health Board, like in Quinault, where he had to walk through water up to his knees to get to his school bus. And then when he would come back from school, he had to walk through that same water that was at his knees to get to his house. So, you know, how our environment impacts us now is very, it also contributes to that trauma. And we're also very rich in culture, and we're rich in teachings that who we are as people, with our relationships with our elders and our relationships with our community members and our understanding of our stories. That's what makes us rich, our understanding of our knowledge, which has been taken away from us. That is something that we need to consider educating people about, because this is math. This is something that my dad has recently done. This is
there was science, technology, engineering, arts, and math in our curriculum prior to colonization that we would use. And now we're at a point where we're able to kind of use our education and our legislation to revitalize that knowledge and to practice it and find ways to use these systems to our benefit through our legislative advocacy and curriculum development. And also, I wanted to add, excuse me, I'm okay. I don't think I want to add anything. There's been a lot of community healing in our environment, whether that's the school system where we're honoring our treaties, but it's taken a lot of community education through music, through plays, through videos, through interviews, through technology development that we've had to use to educate our community about our treaties, about our way of life, and about who we are and where we come from. And we still have a long ways to go because our environment and our language needs us. And there is an act that was recently put into place that it's a Senate bill, and it's created to help repatriate some of the artifacts or the pieces that were taken from us. Our blankets are in the Smithsonian Museum. Our blankets are over in Europe and, over in Quebec. Those are things that connect us to our family, our masks, our things that we had, our necklaces, our jewelry that we have, that was our wealth. It's not only that it was material wealth, it was that it's our intellectual wealth that was taken from us to be shown as something like archaeologically prominent in like an educational community. And so if we can take that back to our community and get help advocating to return some of our items back to us, I can see that as a very healing element. And then also doing ethnobotany and practicing place-based revitalization, I think that would help a lot with the flooding here. If we had, and the water quality, because plants and biodiversity really does help filter out a lot of the pollutants in our water, and it turns it into something good. So just trying not to colonize the land further than it is. I get that farms produce food, but our natural environments produce food, and highly nutrient-rich food at that. That is specific to our environment that I really appreciate.
Thank you so much, all of you. And I, to the point about, repatriation and reparations, the fact is that the project of the United States project is an occupation of indigenous lands. And so this whole space is, in order for there to be a full acknowledgement of the past, there has to be a re-envisioning. If not, there has to be full institutional accountability, which means indigenous sovereignty, full indigenous sovereignty. I think that, there are these sort of topical solves for the harm of settler colonialism on the terms of the oppressor, that's just not going to work. And so it is also for indigenous communities to choose their terms and for those terms to be carried out. So that is what accountability would look like. So with that, I want to thank you amazing, brilliant people for taking time to be in conversation with us today. Sorry, that's my dog. I want to thank you all for your, and apologize for my dog. And thank you for your amazing work. So grateful for you all.
Thank you.
I believe Atina is going to join us on the screen and close our event today. Thank you again to everyone who helped to bring this event together. Thank you to all our incredible presenters, our panelists. Thank you to the Western Region Compact, and thank you to our audience and participants.
Yes, thank you all so very much for joining us today. I was reminded during this conference through a text message from Leanne Akana, who works with me, to mention that the Hawaiian word for wealth is vaivai, W-A-I-W-A-I. And vai also means water. And that is the Hawaiian indigenous word for wealth. Shows us the importance of where we live, and the water is life, as Sadie had said. I want to add my thanks to Carmen's, to the Compacts of the West. I'd like to thank the individuals who were the committee members from Hawaii, Pacific Islands. I'd like to thank Robert Franco, Ula Hossiger, and Krista Heiser. From California, Elaine Ikeda and Piper McGinley. From Washington, Jennifer Hine. From Montana, Josh Vanek and Andrea Vernon. And from Oregon, certainly Carmen Dennison and Delphine DeFrank. And from the National Campus Compact for the help with their technology, Natalie Furlitt. Also, once again, let us thank our sponsors, State Farm Insurance Charitable Foundation, Give Pulse, and Portland State University College of Education for their support of this event. And we would like to say a big mahalo to you for joining us in exploring strategies to renew the promise of full participation in higher education and support in the development of student community and campus resilience by achieving a civic consensus on our responsibilities for racial and environmental justice. We would appreciate your continued support in creating programming like this by filling out the evaluation that will be sent to you today. You will also be receiving a recording of today's conference in the near future. The Continuums of Service event is the first part of a two-part series of virtual conferences. The second event, the Midwest Campus Compact Conference, will take place on May 25th, and you are already registered to participate by coming to today's event. But please tell others that they can still register. The next slide is your invitation to join us for Continuums of Service in 2023 in Hawaii at Kapi'olani Community College. We thank you all very much for joining us today, and we look forward to seeing you at the Midwest event. Aloha, everyone.